So before I get into this, I just want to say that I wrote this script a while ago. I don't even really know when I wrote it. According to Google Docs, the last edit was on May 15th. Yeah, that's been a while, so... you can probably tell the style's a little weird compared to what I've been doing normally, and the video's gonna be far, far shorter than what I would normally do. But this should be good anyways. I need to get this taken care of, and I do have the game all recorded, so I'm just gonna take care of it. The PSP was a really interesting handheld by Sony. I really loved mine, and I played it a metric fuckton. Granted, I predominantly played emulators. A lot of NES games and Game Boy games, admittedly. But, you know, that wasn't an official feature. The official features were, well, PSP games. God of War, being one of Sony's biggest franchises during the PS2's lifetime, obviously had representation on the handheld. This is all just a roundabout way of telling you all that this week's game is going to be God of War Chains of Olympus, here on That Game Review Show. Oh, and my name is James. Yeah. Let's get into it. So this game here is a prequel to the entire series. Well, at least it was until God of War Ascension came out. But seeing as this game does take place a few years into Kratos' service to the gods of Olympus, it does make for a good starting point. Kratos is in the city of Attica, helping defend the city from the armies of the Persians. Obviously, Kratos isn't going to take that shit sitting down, so he goes and fucks up all them fools. After killing the Persian leader and then the basilisk, Kratos witnesses the sun falling from the sky and he runs towards it to check what's happening. He works his way up through the city of Marathon and finally to the temple of Helios, the sun god. Athena, in statue form, tells Kratos that Helios has disappeared and the god of sleep, Morpheus, has started to take over the world of the living. Sounds not too good, right? Well, yeah, because the other gods are also being affected, for some reason. I feel like if Morpheus had the power to affect the other gods, he would have already tried to take over anyways, but that's kind of besides the point. Kratos fights his way through the temple of Helios and meets with Eos, the sister of Helios, and she tells Kratos to use the sun shield and primordial fire to awaken the steeds that pull the chariot. Kratos ends up doing so and they drag him into the underworld. In the underworld, Kratos meets the ferryman, Charon, who taunts Kratos before turning him away, telling him to come back once he's died. Of course, Kratos doesn't like being told no, and they fight, but Charon uses his weird ghost blast boat power and knocks Kratos out. Charon then throws him over the edge of the boat into Tartarus. Kratos awakens, but he's chained up. He ends up breaking free and works his way through the jails of Tartarus. And there he finds the Gauntlet of Zeus, which was used to chain up the Titans, and climbs all the way out, finding himself back at Charon's boat. Kratos, with the Gauntlet of Zeus, destroys the ghost magic pillars and takes out Charon. With Charon dead, Kratos arrives at the Temple of Persephone, where he sees the spirit of his dead daughter, Calliope. So, naturally, being the sentimental bastard he is, Kratos goes after her. He doesn't end up finding her, but he does come across the gates to Elysium, where the goddess Persephone is waiting. She tells Kratos that if he gives up his sins, he can go be with his daughter. This entails getting rid of his white skin, tattoo, and weapons. I want to point out, like, his skin during this became, like, a few shades darker, and it's kind of funny, but I feel like they could have made it a little more apparent. He goes into Elysium, and he hugs his dead daughter, Calliope. But guess what? Persephone is evil! She tricked Kratos into getting rid of all of his powers so that she, with the help of our buddy the Titan Atlas, can destroy the fucking world because she hates being stuck in the underworld like 6 months out of the year. Pretty sure that's why, but it's a little stupid. Anyways, Kratos attacks the peaceful souls and kills them by snapping their necks, and somehow that gives Kratos his weapons and powers back. He leaves his daughter in Elysium crying for her dad. Kratos takes on Persephone, who flies up to the pillar holding the world, and then the two battle. Obviously, Kratos wins and Persephone dies. During the battle, Kratos had actually chained Atlas up to the top of the world, forcing him to hold it forever. After the fight, Atlas gives Kratos an ominous message, telling about how the gods will never release Kratos from his curse. But Kratos stays adamant, and tells the Titan that he will serve the gods until they do end up freeing him. This isn't the last time Kratos and Atlas meet, of course, as we saw in God of War 2. Kratos flies out of the underworld on the Sun Chariot, but the stress of the battle beforehand caused him to pass out and fall off. Before hitting the very familiar ground, his fall was stopped and set down gently. Two figures, Athena and Helios, relieve Kratos of his weapons and powers before leaving him behind. They walk through the portal to Olympus, and Kratos is left there for the credits to roll past. Well, that's the story. Definitely not the most dramatic story that the God of War series has ever had, but it's not bad. I personally prefer the story in God of War Ghost of Sparta, but this is definitely acceptable. The gameplay is pretty standard God of War fare. You're equipped with the Blades of Chaos again, and the gameplay is lifted almost exactly from God of War 2. Due to the limited controls, there were some concessions that had to be made. The magics are set to more of a preset, being a combination of the face buttons and the R trigger. I don't really know why they did it like that, because the D-pad was available to use to select the magics, but that's besides the point. Well, the other weapon Kratos gets, the Gauntlet of Zeus, is equipped by pressing down on the D-pad, so it's not entirely unused. Due to the PSP only having one analog stick, or a slider in this case, they have remapped the evade option by pressing both bumpers and flicking the left stick. And I do have to be honest, I actually really like this control scheme. Even on the PS3 where they did implement right analog evasion, I still usually use the default method just due to how comfortable it was. Seeing as the right stick is only used for evasion, I tend to neglect it in the other games. Sure, there's plenty of people who don't like this method, but I really do. As I had mentioned previously, the Gauntlet of Zeus is another weapon Kratos can get. It's slow and hard-hitting, and also used for some light puzzle solving. And it does act as a nice balance to the much faster Blades of Chaos. Then there are the magics. The Ifrit is a general fire slam that knocks enemies back, and the Primordial Flame is used as a range attack. There is Karin's Mask that acts like a multiple hit attack. It does stunlock enemies, which is nice. The levels in this game are fine. As far as how it compares to the other games, the levels are definitely a little more simplistic and straightforward. Granted, it's not like most of the God of War games have super creative level design all the time, but this is to an extreme. I will say though that the graphics are pretty decent as well. They do look closer to God of War 2, and do look fine blown up on a bigger screen. Obviously, they do look more fine on the PSP's tiny screen, just because that's how it works, but it is definitely fully acceptable. For me personally, I usually consider this game as God of War 1.5. The graphics are somewhere between 1 and 2, and there are some mechanics shared amongst both 1 and 2. Like, the Blades of Chaos share the moveset from 2, but Kratos doesn't get any upgrades akin to the Icarus wings. He does get the ability to breathe underwater, which makes me wonder why Kratos would have given that ability up between this game and 1, but that is just the downside of making a prequel. This game is definitely worth playing if you're a God of War fan. I do hear a lot of negativity surrounding this game, about how it isn't as good or as exciting as the console games, which I say fooey to. This game is pretty good. I can get behind some of the dissatisfaction with the game, but I have spent many hours playing this game, especially on the toilet. It deserves way more credit than it gets. Well, it's the end of the video. I do want to say, this time I do have a far more reasonable goal for what I want to do. Instead of crunching and working on the series back-to-back like I did with Devil May Cry, I'll be trying to finish up the series over the next several months. In March of 2020, God of War 1 will be 15 years old, so I feel like it's only fitting to celebrate it the only way I know how. Making game reviews. So, yeah, when it's my turn in March, get ready. Long video based on God of Thor. Yeah! Anyways, unless things are changed, next week is Terrell's week, so let's meet back here.